understanding of healing led to a new phase in our understanding of human biology when it became obvious that not only is it possible to evoke the healing response from within the human system, but that it's possible to maintain a state of balance for an extended period of time. That human aging, unlike the aging of animals, is much more flexible. Human aging accelerates when you're under stress, it slows down if you're happy, but there are studies now that you can even reverse biological age through certain interventions, including meditation, including nutritional supplements, including physical exercise, yoga, breathing techniques. There's a lot of wonderful research that shows that you can change the biological markers of aging, such as blood pressure, and body temperature regulation, and bone density, and so on. I think we're in the midst of an even better understanding now than that which existed only a few years ago. Most human behavior in the last several thousand years, has been reactive or aggressive behavior because our brain, our nervous system is hardwired for aggression. You know, in a threatening situation, we either run or we fight. So we have a program in our physiology called the fight-flight response. And beyond that, we have something called the reactive response, where instead of fighting or flighting, we try and manipulate or control the situation. And by and large, humanity has functioned based on these two responses. And it's led to a lot of problems. And, you know, at a certain time in our evolutionary history, that was quite good, because in a primordial setting, when we were surrounded by predators, it was a good idea to run or fight. But subsequently, as, you know, civilization progressed, the same fight-flight response has been responsible for all the wars and the Holocaust and so many other problems. But the human nervous system does have other responses. We have an intuitive response, which means we can access a mode of intelligence which is beyond the rational, and yet maybe more contextual and holistic and healing and nourishing and relational, and does not necessarily have a win-lose orientation, and yet maybe more productive in the end. We also have in our nervous system the ability to evoke something which is beyond the intuitive response. You can call it the creative response. Creative response is the ability to manifest something that never existed before, to create something that never existed before. And beyond the creative response is something called the visionary response, where out of your new creation you create a vision that goes beyond your limited individuality. It's a vision that is more global. And finally, beyond the visionary response, we have the sacred response, which means the ability to connect ourselves with our source, with the source of creation, with the source of pure potentiality. So I think we are in the midst of a major shift in our own evolution as a human species. So far, evolution has been always defined in Darwinian terms. In Darwinian, evolution is about survival of the fittest, and it's all, which really means survival of the fiercest, survival of the most aggressive. It served a historical purpose, but it's obsolete now. I think for humans, the next phase of evolution is what you might want to call metabiological evolution, which is beyond biology. It's the evolution of consciousness, and ultimately the evolution of consciousness of consciousness, because we are the only species that is aware of the fact that we are aware. We are the only species that's conscious of consciousness. And as we embark on this metabiological evolution, you know, a famous scientist by the name of Jonas Salk said it will be survival of the wisest instead of survival of the fittest. The wisdom will be the new criteria for fitness. I think that's happening in the world. As we begin to in a sense, dismantle our defenses and approach that domain of our awareness which is more universal and less ethnocentric and less racist and less prejudiced, and go beyond religion to a new experience of spirituality, because religion divides, always divides. Religion has been the most, in a sense, the most dangerous thing in our evolutionary history, ever since the Crusades. But maybe we are going beyond that now.
Cyberspace has the danger that we only see what we want to see. That we only seek out the data that we consider information.
Right.
You share that danger, you see the danger there.
Yeah, it's also the danger when you're going to be choosing from 500 channels in the next couple of years. And in fact, that's how science has operated too, you know. We think science is neutral, it's supposed to be, but after all, remember, who's doing science? Who's doing science? It's a scientist who has his own biases and his own prejudices and his own opinions, and of course if you believe Rupert Sheldrake and others, then the bias of the scientist influences the outcome of the experiment. So by and large that's true of anything that you do, whether you're doing science or whether you're choosing which radio station to tune into or what television channel to tune into.
Isn't there a danger that cyberspace, people getting on the internet, that's a giant excuse for not experience reality as it comes to us now?
I have a very difficult time answering that question because I don't know what reality is other than a symbol. You know, reality is a symbol of your intentionality and what you choose anyway. When the reality is, if I step out of this place and, you know, go to the red light district, that's reality. You know, it's normal reality. Reality going here is reality. It's always a choice, reality. Ultimate reality is beyond that. Ultimate reality is the potentiality to make any choice you want. So I do see that the internet, you know, like anything else, could be really something very important for the healing of the world, or could be very destructive. It depends on whether we as a society are psychotic or not. You know, when the Holocaust happened, you know, most people say, hey, this was Hitler who did the who was responsible. It's not true. I mean, who's Hitler? He's just a second-rate corporal with a poor self-image. It's a collective psyche that has gone psychotic. And one of the symptoms of psychosis is that you don't know you're in it when you're in it. You know, it's only after you wake up from it, or in hindsight, you say, this was psychotic. So, when we are in the midst of a psychosis, we don't know. And then, what is psychosis anyway? You know, I mean, psychosis is what doesn't conform to everybody else's values. See, the whole thing is so bizarrely relative that the best we can hope to do is take care of myself. You know, I want to take care and see that I become a more conscious being. And if I become a more conscious being, and you decide that you also want to be a more conscious being, maybe there are enough conscious beings, the world will change. You know, I sat down when I started with this. I sat down with about 150 people for a 7-day retreat in meditation and said, what do you want to do with your life? And you know, we went 7 days and people came up with 4 things that they wanted to do with their life. Okay, they wanted to heal their life. They wanted to be of service. Okay? They wanted to love. And they wanted to feel harmony with others. And that's how it came about. So now, if that's the mission statement, that you want to serve, that you want to love, you want to be at peace, and you want to have harmony in your life. And you know, if you're an alcoholic, what do? You find fellow alcoholics that can go with you in the bar, right? I mean, like seeks like. It's a human thing. And so there are people who want to do those things. They seek others. I don't think you say, well, if I don't want to do this, I shouldn't seek others of my own kind. I mean, it's only natural to do that. Now, where that will lead 100 years from now, I don't know. But as long as you maintain your values, that's the only thing you can do. That's the best you can do.